Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 3124 in the name of Ivan McKee on Professional Qualifications Bill, UK legislation. I would invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on Ivan McKee to speak to and move the motion for around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Friend Officer, the UK Government announced its Professional Qualifications Bill in the Queen's Speech on the 11th of May last year and announced it in the Lords the following day. The extent of the bill is UK-wide and the bill does not make separate provision for devolved and reserved professions. So the bill applies to all regulated professions whether their regulation are reserved or devolved. The bill defines a regulated profession as a profession which is regulated by law in the UK or a part of the UK. There are three main categories of profession captured under this bill. First, reserved professions such as architecture, vets and medical practitioners. Secondly, those that are devolved. For Scotland, this includes solicitors and advocates, school teachers and social workers. And finally, there are those professions for which there is a mix of reserved and devolved responsibility. The regulation of the majority of healthcare professional groups is reserved. However, the regulation of new groups of healthcare professionals and those regulated since the Scotland Act 1998 is devolved to the Scottish Parliament. For example, the UK-wide Health and Care Professions Council are the regulatory body for the devolved professions of operating department practitioners and practitioner psychologists, and the General Dental Council for dental nurses, dental technicians, clinical dental technicians and orthodontic therapists. Clearly, Presiding Officer, this is a complicated landscape. As well as providing continuity in the provision of an information centre like the one required by the EU, the bill covers the implementation of professional qualification aspects of trade agreements and would enable regulators who do not currently have the power to do so to enter into agreements with overseas counterparts. This latter power is already in place for key Scottish regulators. The Institute of Chartered Accountants in Scotland, for example, has entered into a mutual recognition of professional qualifications agreement with its USA counterpart that isn't replicated across the UK. So these aspects of the bill are not contentious. However, the actions available to a national authority under the bill go much further, and I know that the other devolved administrations have raised concerns about the scope of the bill. The UK Government have sought legislative consent for the bill, but as it stands, the bill would confer concurrent powers on UK ministers, allowing them to act in devolved areas without a provision requiring the consent of Scottish ministers. As such, the bill, as introduced to the House of Lords, could, for example, allow the UK Government to require Scottish regulators to enter into international agreements or accept qualifications from other countries as equivalent without the agreement of Scottish ministers and without any form of scrutiny by the Scottish Parliament. These concerns were also reflected as the bill progressed through the Lords from committee stage on 9th of June to third reading on 17th November. In that debate, responding for the opposition, Baroness Blake said there is a belief that there remains much work to do on the bill in relation to devolved authorities. Just last week, she said, the Minister promised to continue to explore amending the bill to alleviate the justified concerns of the devolved administrations. The UK Government did introduce amendments to improve protection of the autonomy of regulators under the bill and the requirement to consult regulators before a national authority, in other words, the UK or a devolved government, depending on the circumstances, takes actions under the bill. Scottish ministers would support these amendments as a step in the right direction, but they don't go far enough. The underlying issue of the exercise of concurrent powers by UK government ministers without consent was then raised in the Commons by opposition MPs, as has been consistently raised by Scottish Government officials and ministers in meetings with the UK. It is as yet unresolved. Despite officials working to reach agreement with the UK Government and various ministerial meetings emphasising our position, no agreement has been reached. Officials have analysed the issue in detail, and assuming that future UK governments would use the bill in a reasonable and sensible manner, we have not identified a single example where Scottish ministers would wish to withhold consent. Given this, it is unclear to me and my officials why, for this bill, the UK Government would not respect the devolution settlement and include a consent provision in respect of devolved professions. Is it that the UK Government wants to offer to lower professional standards to secure free trade agreements? Is it a power grab? or do the current government simply not respect the institutions of devolution? Two Scottish parliamentary committees have reported on the bill. The reports from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and the Economy and Fair Work Committee both concluded that the Scottish Parliament should have the opportunity to scrutinise the exercise of all legislative powers within its competence effectively, and that the use by the UK Government of powers in devolved areas should require the consent of Scottish Ministers. The Welsh Senedd has debated the bill and will also not be recommending consent to the bill as it stands. Presiding Officer, when respected by the UK Government, the Sewell Convention has served devolution well. As Scottish Ministers and officials have made clear, we would like to be able to recommend consent to this bill, but as it stands, we cannot. If this Parliament does not give its consent to the bill, the Sewell Convention requires UK ministers either to amend the bill or exclude devolved matters from it. So far, there is no sign of either. From Brexit to Sewell to the proposals to rip up the Human Rights Act, the UK Government's lack of respect for Scotland's devolution settlement is clear and deeply troubling. In more than 20 years of devolution, the Convention has been breached four times, all in relation to Brexit, and three of these under the current Prime Minister. I hope this bill will not end up being the fifth time. Presiding Officer, the Mutual Recognition of Professional Qualifications, MRPQ, is important, and this is reflected in its inclusion in our vision for trade. MRPQ allows our professionals to export professional services and gain valuable experience in other countries, and professionals qualified elsewhere to settle and contribute in Scotland. However, that should not lead to Scottish ministers losing their responsibility to govern in devolved areas, or this Parliament losing its role in scrutinising those areas. This bill, as it currently stands, would mean just that if legislative consent were given. I move that the Parliament backs the motion, refuses legislative consent to the bill as it stands, and backs our request for a suitable amendment to be made to the bill that respects this Parliament's role in scrutinising the regulation of devolved professions. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now call on Claire Baker to speak on behalf of the Economy and Fair Work Committee for around 4 minutes, please, Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to contribute to the debate as convener of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. So after considering the initial LCM on Professional Qualifications Bill on the 29th of September, we published our report on the 22nd November 21, while recognising that the Scottish Government was working to secure amendments to address the shared concerns. In this report, we shared the concerns raised by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, agreeing that the Scottish Parliament should be able to scrutinise the exercise of legislative powers within devolved competence. Under the current bill, there is no means for the Scottish Parliament to do so when regulations are laid by the UK Government that fall within devolved competence. This is proving to be a recurring issue. In our report on the initial LCM, we were also concerned that the combined effect of the UK Internal Market Act and this legislation means that it is possible that in some cases the Scottish Parliament may not even be made aware of regulatory changes in another part of the UK that would be affecting devolved areas. So under our scrutiny of the initial LCM, we appreciated the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee sharing concerns with us regarding the potential for unintended consequences around health and social care workforce planning should regulations be made by the UK ministers which contradict or interfere with the Scottish Government strategy. We share this concern and agree that a scrutiny role for the Scottish Parliament is vital, including the ability to track regulatory changes being made in relation to the health and social care workforce in Scotland, and this is relevant to other professions. Following the publication of a report into the initial LCM, we were anticipating a supplementary LCM from the Scottish Government, given the amendments at Westminster. While the Scottish Government was aware of amendments had been agreed, requiring a supplementary LCM in November 21, a supplementary memorandum was not lodged until the 27th of January 2022. It is regrettable that this gave the committee a very short time to consider the issues and formulate a position. Although important, the Government's initiation of today's debate did further reduce the time available for the committee's scrutiny, which is again regrettable. The truncated time that is being given to committees to scrutinise LCMs is an issue I intend to raise with the conveners group. While the challenging timescales have been involved, the committee did publish a report yesterday on the supplementary memorandum. The committee does welcome the amendments made to the bill, which address issues in relation to regulatory autonomy and regulatory consultation. However, substantive concerns do remain. There are five key recommendations from our report on the initial LCM that are still not addressed. That is, a requirement should be on the face of the bill to obtain the consent of Scottish ministers before making regulations in areas of devolved competence. There should be a scrutiny role for the Scottish Parliament in relation to health and social care workforce planning to avoid unintended consequences where regulations are made by the UK Government that may impact, even inadvertently, upon Scottish Government policy in devolved areas. The Scottish Government should demonstrate how it will track and keep this Parliament informed about regulatory changes being made in other parts of the UK which affect areas of devolved competence. A process should be put in place to ensure early notification and opportunities for parliamentary scrutiny of intra-government communications. And the issues raised by the Delegated Powers Committee in relation to appropriateness of delegating the powers in clauses 1 and 3 should be pursued. So, Presiding Officer, I recognise the UK Government says it does not intend to make regulations in areas of devolved competence without the agreement of the relevant devolved administrations. The committee, however, shares the concerns raised by the Scottish Government. This commitment is not on the face of the bill. This results in no mechanism to enable the Scottish Parliament to scrutinise UK ministers' regulations under the bill, which are within the Scottish Parliament's competence. A consent requirement would give this Parliament its appropriate place in the process. The view of the Economy and Fair Work Committee is that the legislation should require the UK Government to obtain the consent of the devolved administrations in areas of devolved competence. If that is truly the UK Government's intention, then surely there is nothing to prevent including a consent mechanism. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms Baker, I now call on Tess White for around 6 minutes. Ms White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the UK Government's Professional Qualifications Bill aims to create a new legislative framework for recognising professional qualifications gained outside the UK. This framework will replace existing EU-derived law in this area, with more than 200 professions regulated by law in the UK. This is a significant undertaking. Feedback from regulators such as the Law Society of Scotland suggests that the bill has been improved during its passage in the UK Parliament, and that constructive engagement has taken place with the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy during the amending stage, when proposed changes were rigorously debated. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's supplementary legislative consent memorandum rightly emphasises that many aspects of the bill are not contentious. While the SNP Chief Whip in Westminster stated during the bill's second reading that the SNP is not against the principles of the bill. It's clearly not the policy intention of the bill that the Scottish Government opposes, but the process through which its provisions are implemented. And the reason why this legislation is required in the first place, I will address each of these points in turn. On the issue of process, it's important to recognise at the outset that the Sewell Convention was engaged, and that the UK Government has been negotiating extensively with the devolved administrations to find consensus on areas of divergence. That point was specifically made by Ivan McKee in his evidence to the Economy and Fair Work Committee on the 29th of September 2021, highlighting that there is ongoing engagement at official level, and that the Minister was in contact with Jerry Grimston, the relevant UK minister. It was also made in Ivan McKee's letter of the 23rd of November to the committee, which referred to continuing discussion with BEIS. The main point of contention for the Scottish Government is outlined in paragraph 20 of the supplementary legislative consent memorandum, namely concerns around the exercise of concurrent powers and the definition of appropriate national authority and issues relating to consent. On concurrent powers, this approach has been taken by the UK Government to ensure that professions which fall within devolved legislative competence but are regulated on a UK-wide basis can be dealt with effectively and appropriately under the bill by the relevant and appropriate national authority. To address the concerns of the Scottish and Welsh governments, the UK government suggested putting a duty to consult on the face of the bill. This would require the Secretary of State or the Lord Chancellor to consult with the devolved administrations before making regulations under the bill that fall within devolved competence. and to publish a report on the consultation. There has therefore been significant movement by the UK government which would preserve the balance of the devolution settlement while maintaining a coherent approach across the UK. This proposal would also mitigate some of the concerns raised by the Economy and Fair Work and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committees. Presiding Officer, given the SNP concerns that the bill impinges on devolved competence, it is worth pointing out that the Scottish Government was content with the operation of the former system on the recognition of qualifications under EU law, with the UK making decisions as the member state. Turning next to the reason why this legislation is required, the UK's withdrawal from the EU. The SNP seems to agree with the principles of the bill, yet it expresses opposition, at least in part, because of Brexit. MSPs had this argument many times in the chamber, but it bears repeating. The UK, which Scotland voted to remain part of in 2014, voted to leave the EU 2 years later. That outcome was a source of sadness and regret for many, but they have nevertheless accepted it as a democratic process. Two final points, Presiding Officer. The first being technical in nature. The Scottish Government's motion today references the Economy and Fair Work Committee's report published on the 22nd of November 2021, a report which concluded in paragraph 58 that the committee was not in a position to take a view on the LCM at the time. The member talks about the lack of respect. The member says scrutiny is important, and I'm glad he said that, because the committee's report on the supplementary legislative consent memorandum published yesterday raised concerns about the amount of time that the Scottish Government took to lodge a supplementary LCM, which was more than 2 months overdue. Along with the Scottish Government's timetabling of today's debate, the committee felt that these factors limited its ability to conduct detailed scrutiny. Yeah. And you might look at me. Presiding Officer, we believe the bill provides stability for qualifications and that it prevents a divergence of professional qualifications regulations within the UK. We note the extensive engagement between the UK and the Scottish Governments to date regarding the bill's provisions, and that the Scottish Government is supportive of the general principles. Overall, we are in favour of consenting to the bill, and we will vote against the motion at decision time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. White. I now call on Martin Whitfield for around 5 minutes, please, Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to speak in this debate. We find ourselves in an unusual position where, following our departure from the European Union, where over decades regulations and rules were brought about, driven by professions across Europe, to ensure that the recognition of the skills, competencies, honesty and otherwise of various professions was reflected across the European Union. And the purpose of this was, of course, so that people could ply their trade where they chose to be. But it also came at a time when recognition of devolved professions was also coming to the fore. With the devolution settlement, and even before that, here in Scotland, we had a distinct and separate group of professions. And I would like to take the short time that I have this afternoon just to discuss two of those professions. The first is obviously the legal profession, and the second one, which is very close to my heart, education and schools, through the General Teaching Council of Scotland, which I had a pleasure to serve on as a council member some while ago. And it is fascinating that within this bill that is making its way through the Parliament at Westminster, these two groups came to advocate for their own identity and their own professional competencies. And it was interesting to listen to Tess White, and I'm slightly saddened that she was unable to take my intervention when she talked about the assurances that the Westminster government, Tory government, have given to the devolved nations, it doesn't seem a large step from saying, we will talk to you, we promise, to actually putting that on the face of the bill so that the people of the devolved nations can look and say, there's the respect that we are due. And in turn, those devolved governments would take and consult with those professions that within their ambit regulate themselves. I think of the Law Society for Scotland and the General Teaching Council for Scotland. But to turn to some very specifics in the short time that I have left, with regard to teaching, there was a consultation put out by the government, and indeed the General Teaching Council of Scotland responded to it. They have responded to a number of these items in seeking to protect access to the profession for those people who are properly qualified, because we are very proud in this nation to have a graduate profession or graduate equivalent profession that empowers those people to teach our youngsters. And indeed, in the consultation to the government, they stated that they actively participated in the discussion of new legislation, including the Internal Market Bill and the Professional Qualifications Bill, which we deal with today. GTC Scotland is strongly opposed to any proposal which could erode or dilute the integrity of the Register of Teachers through changes to qualification requirements or similar. And that's where the fear in this bill lies, that there is a change made in the South that will affect them, and it will be made without proper and full consultation. And it is for this chamber, and it is for our government here to represent our independent bodies like GTCS to defend their position. Again, with regard to the Law Society of Scotland, mention was made of their support for this bill. And it is right to say that they supported, in the main, the provisions of the bill. But they did specifically draw attention to Article 7, which is this organisation, this group, that information can be sought from by people who want to practice their profession in the United Kingdom from elsewhere in Europe, or indeed those professionals from within the United Kingdom who want to practice abroad. And the reason that the Law Society of Scotland raised issue with this is not because it's not a good idea, but there is a vital importance that proper consultation should take place with the various professional bodies across the United Kingdom so that the correct information is made. I do have some concerns, which are perhaps on a technical level, about the cost and the finance implications of that centre, but they're perhaps for another day. To come to the heart of it, and we've heard from speakers this afternoon, that is this a constitutional argument about should or should not this chamber and this government be consulted? I think it's something more fundamental than this. This bill had to be rushed through because of a choice made in a referendum, and then the vehicle of that choice pursued by the Conservative government down south, and confronted the United Kingdom with a problem of how professionals are going to ply their trade across the European Union. It was an opportunity for Westminster to hold out their hand, to listen, to discuss, and then to reflect those discussions on the face of the bill, not on side-by-side letters and promises that were made. And it is right that both in Wales and in Scotland there is dismay at the approach that's been taken, and that is a disappointment. So I support the government's motion today, and honestly, I feel the Westminster government could have done a lot better. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whitfield. I now call on the Minister to wind up the debate for around 3 minutes or so.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to members for taking part in the debate today, short as it has been, but a very important issue, as Martin Whitfield has clearly outlined, impacting on many of the professions across Scotland. And I welcome the support that's been shown by him and by the Scottish Parliamentary Committees for the government's position on this very important issue. And as I said in my opening statement, MRPQ benefits skilled Scottish workers looking to work abroad and helps us to attract the skilled labour our businesses and public services need. And this is something we want to encourage to enable Scotland to continue to grow and prosper. And it's true that it can sometimes be appropriate for UK government ministers to act on Scotland's behalf, and we've seen this on numerous occasions over the last couple of years, but it should always be with the consent of Scottish ministers, and this Parliament must have the opportunity to scrutinise actions taken using powers in devolved areas. This underpins devolution, and indeed consent has been given to Brexit-related UK statutory instruments in relation to MRPQ, where they touch on devolved issues. I hope that the Parliament will agree with me and the recommendation for not giving consent to the bill as it currently stands. I feel if the bill was given consent in its current form, this would set a dangerous precedent for future bills with concurrent powers, where the UK Government would seek to act in devolved areas without the consent of Scottish ministers. This is not something we can or should agree to, and I know this view is shared by our colleagues and ministers in both Wales and in Northern Ireland. Members have heard today we will do everything we can to protect devolution and Scotland's interests. We will continue to engage and work with the UK Government to try to convince them to include an appropriate consent mechanism on the face of what would otherwise now be an uncontentious bill. And it's very interesting to note the complete disrespect for devolution emanating from the Conservative benches on this matter, and really informs our opinion of the position that they take with regards to their attitude to this Parliament, to devolution in its entirety, and indeed to Scotland, something that the voters of Scotland are increasingly coming to recognise. Presiding Officer, I move that this Parliament backs the motion, refuses legislative consent to the bill as it stands, and backs our request that the UK Government lodge a suitable amendment to the bill that respects Scottish ministers and this Parliament's responsibilities in respect of devolved professions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate on Professional Qualifications Bill UK legislation. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. There'll be a brief pause before we do so.